I welcome you all for today's online class on pertussis and its etiological agent, the Bordetella pertussis. The disease pertussis is also known as whooping cough. It is also known as 100-day cough. This is a highly communicable disease and is quite common in childhood. So it is one of the most important childhood diseases. Please remember that it is one of the most highly communicable diseases with 80 to 85% communicability. The disease is called pertussis because it is derived from the Latin words. Tussis means coughing. Pertussis means extensive coughing or severe coughing. The name whooping cough has come because of the whooping sound that is made by the patient after a fit of coughing, or what is known as a paroxysmal coughing. After a gap of continuous coughing, the patient makes an inspiratory sound, which is called as a whoop, and that is why the disease is called whooping cough. Now, pertussis is endemic in all the countries. Worldwide, there have been more than 1.5 lakh cases reported. This is 2018 data. And from India alone, there were 23,776 cases reported in 2017. So pertussis is a significant disease in India as well. The case fatality depends on the age group. In infants, it's less than a year old child, that's less than 12 months, it is 4%. And in children of 1 to 4 years old, it is approximately 1%. So as you can see, the fatalities are more in infants. What is the source of this infection? Humans are the exclusive source. Pertussis is an exclusive human disease. It does not exist in any animal. So it is only the patients and those with atypical infections who can transmit this disease. Now, when I say patients, it is only at the catarrhal stage who are communicable, who are infective, not the other stages. Often, it is the adults and adolescents who have atypical infections or who have not been diagnosed as suffering from pertussis are the sources as well as the reservoirs of infections. So most often the adults or adolescents don't even know, or they are not even aware that they are shedding the bacterium. So they happen to be the source when they come in contact with infants. The mode of transmission is the inhalation of airborne droplets. So when the person is infected, coughs or sneezes, the droplets are released into the air, and when these droplets are inhaled, susceptible individuals get infected. Now let us look at the age group which are affected. Even though pertussis is a childhood disease, remember that it can also affect adolescents and adults. However, it is more common in preschool children of less than 5 years of age. Even if the mother has some immunity, the maternal antibodies that would have crossed over to the newborn is not protective. And if you look at the adults, even if they had taken immunization, the immunity provided by vaccines is not lifelong. The immunity wanes. So therefore, the adolescents and adults may suffer from atypical infections and can be responsible for transmitting the disease. Now let's have a look at the pathogenesis of this disease. Pertussis is caused by the main pathogen, Bordetella pertussis. However, there are other species such as Bordetella bronchiseptica, Bordetella parapertussis, and Bordetella holmesii. These are usually associated with infections in animals, but can also cause infections in humans. These are lesser common. But the most important one is Bordetella pertussis. Now, following inhalation along the droplet, The bacteria first goes and adheres to the epithelial cells with the help of fimbriae and other adhesive factors, about which I'll talk later. Once it adheres to the respiratory tract, the upper respiratory tract, there it elicits a variety of toxins and biological active substances which damage the ciliated epithelial cells. Now, there are some cells called the goblet cells which produce mucus. These ciliated cells, which are present in the upper respiratory tract, trap all the microorganisms, dust, pollen, etc., as well as the mucus. These are cleared through what is known as the nasociliary escalator. Because of the beating of the cilia, these are rapidly cleared. But once these epithelial cells are damaged, the mucus is no longer clear. And therefore, this persistent presence of mucus irritates the respiratory tract, which induces coughing in the patient. You must know that this is basically a localized infection of the ciliated epithelium of the bronchial tree. However, be informed that it can also extend down into the lungs and can also cause pneumonia, but that is less common. Let's briefly look at the virulence factors. Bordetella pertussis have a variety of virulence factors. The degree of importance varies. Fimbriae, pertactin, and filamentous hemagglutinin. These three are adhesins. That is, these three help the bacteria to adhere to the epithelial cells. Pertactin is an outer membrane protein. Once it adheres, it releases certain toxins. Tracheal cytotoxin. This toxin mainly affects the ciliated cells. It induces the production of interleukin-1 alpha and nitric oxide, which ultimately leads to the loss of ciliated cells. Cell blebbing, the membrane bulges here, that is called cell blebbing, and the damage to mitochondria. So basically what happens here is tracheal cytotoxin damages the ciliated epithelial cells. Adenylate cyclase. This component is anti-inflammatory and anti-phagocytic because it preferably acts on polymorphonuclear neutrophils as well as peripheral blood monocytes. By inhibiting these two, they are anti-inflammatory. Pertussis toxin. This toxin, just like the cholera toxin, is composed of A and B units. As always, B binds and A is active. The A unit enters into the cell. It also activates adenylyl cyclase, which ultimately results in accumulation of cyclic AMP. And this has various effects, such as improved adhesion to the ciliated cells, non-specific stimulation of the T cells, this is called mitogenicity, inhibition of the phagocytes, which I mentioned earlier. It also induces leukocytosis and also induces hypoglycemia by increased insulin secretion. Another component of the bacterium is lipopolysaccharide, which is similar among all gram-negative bacteria. Lipopolysaccharides are endotoxic in nature. Now let us examine the clinical disease. The incubation period of pertussis is around 7 to 10 days, but it can vary from 21 days. The clinical manifestation in a patient depends on the age, the immunization status, prior infection, presence of an antibody, or antibiotic treatment. The classical illness, which is the primary infection, is seen in unimmunized children. Please note that this lasts for 6 to 12 weeks, but it can last even longer. So, the clinical illness or the classical illness of pertussis is known to occur in three stages. First, catarrhal, two, paroxysmal, and three, convalescent. Apart from the classical illness, it can also manifest as atypical pertussis. This is often seen in adolescents who have been immunized, or in adults where the disease is less severe in nature but can include prolonged coughing which is not paroxysmal in nature. So we have the classic illness and the atypical pertussis. Now let's look at the first one, the catarrhal stage. So this runs for around 1 to 2 weeks. It begins just like common cold, or it resembles a rhinoviral infection where the patient may have only running nose, tearing in eyes, mild cough, malaise, and low-grade fever. In some, fever may not even be present. But during the course of illness, the cough get worsens. And remember that this is the stage where the patient is highly infectious. Often, nobody notices that this could be pertussis. It is often dismissed as common cold. But at this stage, the patient is highly infectious. And if smear and culture is done, it would be positive. But unfortunately, many times this stage is missed. I mean, laboratory diagnosis is hardly performed at this stage. Now we come to the most important stage, the paroxysmal stage. This is characterized by repeated coughing fits. Now, as I told you earlier, it is because of the inability of the body to clear the respiratory tract of the accumulated mucus. So therefore, there is intensive coughing. So it can happen 5 to 10 or more forceful coughs during a single expiration. What happens here is there is a severe bout of coughing, continuous stage of coughing, and the patient is unable to breathe in. This happens during expiration. And once this ends, then the patient has a massive inspiratory effort. So this creates the whoop sound, for which the disease is called the whooping cough. So when there is paroxysmal cough, the patient will have cyanosis, eyes could bulge, tongue could protrude, there is salivation, lacrimation, and the veins in the neck are distended and is often followed by vomiting. So after the paroxysm of cough ends, the child may vomit. Now, in between the paroxysms, the patient may appear normal. So between two episodes, the patient may appear completely normal. This often worsens at night. So please remember that this paroxysm can occur several times in an hour or 5 to 10 times in a day. At the end of this paroxysm, the child is exhausted. And eating may trigger paroxysm. So therefore, the child tries to avoid eating food. And ultimately, this may lead to weight loss. At this stage, fever is not there. Sputum production is also not there. And cultures, if performed at this stage, are usually negative. So often, the parents of the children seek medical help at this stage. And by this time, bacteria are no longer recoverable from the patient. So therefore, cultures may be negative at this stage. So this stage, that is a paroxysmal stage of pertussis, lasts for 2 to 8 weeks. In some cases, it can even be paroxysm creates a whooping sound. Now we come to the third stage, the convalescent stage. This lasts for 1 to 2 weeks or longer. Here, both the severity of the disease and the frequency of the paroxysmal cough decreases. And now the antibodies start appearing in the serum. So if serological test is done at this stage, it turns positive. Now let us examine the complications. There are several complications that can happen, and these are the complications that can lead to the death of the patient. Now, there are complications can be either neurological, or it could be infective, or it could be pressure related. These include pneumonia, otitis media, seizures, and encephalopathy. Neurological complications may also present as convulsions or coma. Seizures and encephalopathy are probably due to the cerebral hypoxia, which is due to the severe paroxysms. Rupture of the alveoli may lead to emphysema. Pneumonia can occur either because of Bordetella pertussis, which reaches down into the lungs, or it can be secondary bacterial, which can be because of pneumococcus, haemophilus, staphylococcus aureus, and so on. Now let us look at the complications arise which arise because of the pressure caused due to paroxysmal coughing. Subarachnoid and intraventricular hemorrhage, subdural and spinal epidural hematoma, epistaxis, melena, subconjunctival hemorrhage, rupture of the diaphragm, umbilical and inguinal hernia, rectal prolapse, apnea, rib fracture, and so on. Severe alkalosis, which are associated with tetanic seizures, may also be seen, and the patient can also be dehydrated. Now let us look at the laboratory diagnosis. How are we going to diagnose a case of pertussis with the help of laboratory aids? We'll start with specimen collection. The specimen of choice is nasopharyngeal secretion. This can be collected either by way of aspiration or by using swabs. It is the per nasal swab that has to be collected. As you can see in the picture here, it is the per nasal swab that has to be collected here. Earlier, cuff plate method was used. By cuff plate method, a plate, the culture medium was kept exposed in front of the mouth of the patient, and the patient was asked to cuff straight into the plate. This is no longer recommended. And the practices of taking nasal swab or posterior nasal swab are no longer followed. It is only the per nasal swab. Here, you must bear in mind that cotton swab should not be taken because fatty acids which are present in the cotton fibers can be inhibitory to bacteria. However, this fatty acids can be neutralized if we can use charcoal. So what you see here is a transport medium, Stewart's transport medium, which contains charcoal. So this charcoal will neutralize any fatty acids that may be present on cotton swabs. Rayon or Dacron, these are the synthetic polyester swabs. These are the preferred ones. Calcium alginate swabs can also be taken, but it should not be taken if PCR has to be performed. Remember that calcium alginate swabs are not recommended if PCR has to be performed because it is inhibitory to some steps in PCR. Now, how many samples can we collect? Single sample may not be useful because it may come negative. So therefore, it is advised that 6 samples be taken in 1 or 2 days interval. That is 3 samples today, 3 samples next day, or 2 samples on 3 consecutive days. If there is a delay, then transport media can be used. Transport media used are either Stewart's medium, Reagan-Love medium, or Jones-Kendrick medium. Now let us see, once the sample is collected, what can be done? Smears can be performed and stained by Gram staining. They are not possible, which is helpful only in rare cases. The smears can also be stained by fluorescent dyes. Immunofluorescence can be also performed, but it has poor sensitivity and specificity. So generally, smears are not that helpful. Culture. Now, as I already mentioned, cultures are best done during the catarrh stage. However, often it is missed. They become negative within 5 days of starting antibiotics. So after the antibiotics have been initiated, its value is only up to 5 days. Thereafter, it becomes negative. Now, which are the culture media that are used? Traditionally, it was the Bordet Gengo medium or Bordet Gengo agar. This was used. This is no longer used. Jones-Kendrick agar can also be used, but the medium of choice is the Reagan-Love agar. It is basically charcoal agar, which is supplemented with 10% horse blood because this is a fastidious bacterium. And it may or may not contain cephalaxin, which can serve to inhibit other unwanted bacteria. The plates after inoculation are incubated at 35 to 36 degrees in humid air. Remember that this is an aerobic bacterium, and has to be incubated for at least a week and must be inspected daily. Colonies generally appear in 3 to 5 days, but if they don't appear, the plates must be incubated and observed daily for 1 week. And when colonies appear on this medium, they are grayish white in color, slightly convex and shiny. That is why these colonies are described as mercury drop or bisected pearls appearance. And when smears are made from the colony, they appear as gram-negative cocoa bacilli with loose clumps with some space in between. Now, this is described as thumbprint appearance. Have a look at this picture here. This is the picture of the smear made from the sample. There are lots of pus cells and there are some bacilli here. This is a smear taken from the colonies. This is described as thumbprint appearance. And this is the colonies which you can be described as the dissected pearl appearance or mercury drop appearance. After culture, now we look at the serodiagnosis. Serodiagnosis is by collecting serum sample from the patient. Here, either we can take a single serum sample or we can take paired sera. If you are taking single serum sample, then you have to demonstrate either IgG or IgM by ELISA. Usually what happens is by the time the patient reports, the IgM is gone and IgG is the only thing that can be found. So if it is in the paroxysmal stage, then probably IgG would be better. Earlier, the sera were tested by complement fixation or the bacterial agglutination assay. If antibodies were to be detected by this method, then paired sera should be taken and a rise in titer by two or more folds should be demonstrated between the acute phase and convalescent phase samples. So if one sample is to be taken, then IgG, IgA or IgM can be detected by ELISA. If two samples are taken, then you must demonstrate rise in titer between acute and convalescent phase by complement fixation or agglutination test. Molecular techniques available are PCR or isothermal loop mediated amplification techniques. During outbreaks, epidemiological typing can be performed either by serotyping or by genotyping. Let's have a look at the bacterium. Bordetella pertussis was described by Bordet and Gangu in 1906. It's a gram-negative cocoa bacilli that belongs to the family Alkaligenaceae. These bacteria may be capsulated. These are seen only in young cultures. In older cultures, they may not be found. They are non-motile, but they have fimbriae. When stained with toluidine blue, they may demonstrate bipolar metachromatic granules. Please remember this as a viva question. It's a strict aerobe and is fastidious. It does not grow on McConkie or blood agar. It is oxidase and catalase positive. Optimal temperature is 35 to 37 degrees. It requires a nicotinamide supplement. Remember that growth can be inhibited by the presence of fatty acids, metal ions, sulfides, peroxides, and so on. It is divided into four serotypes based on fimbrial and lipopolysaccharide antigens. Now let us look at the treatment and prophylaxis. Treatment. Once the disease sets in, which is the disease because of the toxins, antibiotics have no effect on the toxins. However, antibiotics of macrolide class can be used, erythromycin or azithromycin or the antibiotics of choice. There are some strains which may be resistant to erythromycin. In such situation, cotrimoxazole can be used. Erythromycin is also used as a chemoprophylactic agent and is given to the household contacts of the cases. If you look at the prophylaxis, DPT vaccine, this has been, this is the vaccine which has been administered under our national immunization program. It is heat inactivated whole cell vaccine. Now, I told you in my previous class that it is administered as a pentavalent vaccine, which is given along with the diphtheria, pertussis, and haemophilus and hepatitis B. It is given subcutaneously at 6, 10, and 14 weeks of age, and it is followed by two booster doses, one at 1.5 years and then at the 5 years of age. Now, there are some complications associated with this, such as encephalitis and convulsions. It is not indicated for children above 5 years or those with history of epilepsy or other neurological conditions. Therefore, now vaccines have been made, which is known as acellular vaccine, that is, the bacteria is removed. It contains only the pertussis toxoid, filamentous hemagglutinin, pertactin, or fimbriae. So now this vaccine is safer. It can be given to children older than 5 years. In Western countries, there have been fears that the whole cell vaccine is associated with autism. There is a debate going on. Anyway, acellular vaccine is a good alternative, but in India, we are still using the acellular vaccine, which is given as pentavalent vaccine.